When doing a clinic, you must be noticing at some point who's like following what you're doing drum-wise, and who's, well, okay, appreciating it, but not quite being able to analyze or dissect what you've been doing. Do you find it difficult to kind of like make yourself remember to play for everybody, or do you kind of like try to, you know, reach out to somebody because you see you can in a different, more in a deeper way, or do you always play for everybody that's in the house?
Well, I hope I'm playing for everybody. I can't honestly tell if the people in the audience are getting it or not. Sometimes somebody will ask a really technical question, so I get an understanding that maybe they're not a beginner or they're quite advanced, but I'm also looking at, you know, people who may be 10 years old. There might be people in there who are much, much older. So I'm aware that it's not a masterclass full of guys of a certain ability. So, yeah, there's no point for me to spend all night talking about something really complex. But to answer your question, I can't really see the recognition on every face, whether they're getting it or not. So I hope they are getting it.
Yeah, I don't have a clue either. When if somebody claps, I don't know whether or not it's because the move appeared to be entertaining or because they knew what it was. I really don't know. But the thought, what am I doing? How am I reaching people? That does affect me, because I have played things that I thought everyone just understood. 20 years ago, more than that, I thought everybody understood it. And apparently no, that wasn't the case. So I would play polyrhythmic things that for me are musical. For anybody that has earned the privilege of enjoying them, appeared to be musical too. So, you know, I just found out eventually by reading what people thought, and if I sounded like a science project or someone thought I was just trying to impress them, it didn't hurt my feelings. It helped me to make a change. Like, well, what am I doing? And then eventually I'm like, well, I got to play for me too. And then, no, maybe I shouldn't do that. And then, well, I'll play for you. And then, well, that was over the top. I just played a beat for a while. Then someone thought I wasn't impressive enough or something. I don't know. It's all just a big ball of mess sometimes. I can't really answer it fully. I never know.
Right.
Alright, now a question to Mike again this time, because you play really like different stuff. For example, the first big band you ever been in was Annihilator, Jim Peters Annihilator, and I was actually wondering, do you remember anything from the time when you actually recorded Set the World on Fire, because actually it had three drummers, and yeah. There were three drummers on the record. And, you know, you did the tour of Annihilator, and then almost 2 decades later, you sort of returned to record 2 more albums with them. So, how could you describe this, you know, whole Annihilator relationship with the...
Well, my first big band was in junior high school.
Oh.
Literally.
Really?
Big band. You know, get it?
Oh, like Glenn Miller's stuff.
Jazz?
Yeah.
Swing?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Anyway, I don't know how big does a band have to be considered big? Maybe just you mean well-known or known by people, you know, I don't know. But with Annihilator in particular, my experience was that was the first record I was called in an emergency situation to help. And really, it's the first time I learned about a click and where to play within that range. They recorded, I missed a snare drum hit somewhere, I don't know, I had recorded like 2 sections of a song and they stopped. And I was like, what'd you do? What happened? And they're like, well, you were a little late on that snare drum hit. I said, late? What are you talking about? No, I wasn't. And they said, yes, you were. No, I wasn't. Yes, you were. I said, no, I don't know what you mean. I don't understand. And they were so nice. The producer took me and he said, here, took the 2-inch tape and he says, this is the click, and this is your snare drum hit. And I said, oh, how late is that? Can we figure it out? I mean, they took time to take a delay. They had to do it manually to tell me how many milliseconds I missed that darn hit by. And it changed my life. I went home and realized, I took my 4-track, that I couldn't play 3 out of 10 hits on my bass drum at 40 beats per minute on the metronome. I couldn't even begin to get close to it. I don't know if I could ever really do it perfectly to this day, but I'm a lot closer, and I can hear 3 milliseconds now. So that's the effect. So when I had an opportunity later on to go back, I thought, you know what, I haven't been put through a grid situation to the level of that I went through with Annihilator, where every single hit was I had to fix or I had to punch in. I had never experienced that. I played a song from beginning to end my whole life. Punch in? That was way, oh my God, I can't do that. But I had no choice. So I went back, yeah, a decade or two later to test how I was doing. That's why. It was important, plus it was fun.
And how did you feel about coming back to that after those?
It was hard again, but it was a lot easier this time. Second time and third time. Oh, yeah.